So, as I say, first, John Albert, Matt O'Neill, the two directors, and also camera person, and the Professor Shaning, Ming Xia, and myself. We went there on the 22nd, and when we first got there, we didn't realize the extent of destruction. But once we start driving into the countryside, we realize it was really very, very serious. By that time, however, it's 10 days after the initial earthquake, so most of the rescue effort has already completed. And the bodies, most of the body has been dug out. So it just happened at that time, on the very second day we went there, we just encountered these demonstrations. And on the second day, on the third day. So we, that was the very, very beginning of this particular situation. And many, many reporters were there, but I think we're the only foreign reporters able to get video pictures out. Chinese reporters, many of them were there, but none of their stuff could go up. And there were no other film crew there. I guess there was one, but French. So we're the only one really got this footage at the very, very beginning of this. So it's and we also witnessed the change of Chinese government policy. As you probably know, at the very beginning, when the earthquake happened, the Chinese government, central propaganda ministry, ordered no Chinese reporter could allow to go to the disaster site. However, Chinese paper, most editors ignored that order and went. And as soon as they sent message back about what happened, the whole country became mobilized. By that time, the Chinese government were not able to stop it. So they went along. So what you got, a lot of footage was heroic rescue effort. It's a really, really a genuine national mobilization. So reporters was, foreign reporters, Chinese reporters were there. And so it just happened when we got touch on this story, the Chinese authority became very unhappy. And so as we go along, the coverage become more and more and more difficult, even though we're able to get a lot of footage. Now, our original purpose was not about this. The HBO commissioners to do a story about Chinese earthquake. In the mind from the executive producer, Sheila Nevins, that she thought natural disaster is a very important issue for various countries, and how they deal with it is very, very important. And she felt that the way that Americans dealt with Katrina was problematic. So when she first saw the first few days about this national mobilization, she was very, very impressed, and she thought maybe we could get some understanding about what was going on. And so we were basically going there to look for a macro, bigger picture. Somehow there's some historical meaning. And after all, HBO is not a news gathering network. You all know. HBO basically is documentary. And however, when we got there, we had this news. And also, as we go on, the obstruction became so severe, after we got enough footage, we decided we had to leave. And just before we left, without knowing, none of us knew, they were chasing after us from the local area all the way to Chengdu, the city that we were staying at. And they detained us and questioned us, and somehow felt that somehow, how come you were at two separate demonstrations? And they want to know what kind of, implying that somehow we had something to do with all this thing going on. But in any event, so we were detained, questioned for 8 hours, and then finally we returned. Now, after we returned, we thought, well, this is a story. It's not completed. All right? We thought it's still a macro story. But the problem is we couldn't get in it back again. Plus the fact the material itself stands as it is. Even 1 year after the event, it's still relevant. So the very last point you saw on the steel is about that parents, 58 parents, although were given money basically to shut up, but they still didn't want to. And they hired a lawyer from Shanghai and to try to figure out who is really responsible. But at the end, the court basically says no, rejected their appeals. Now, subsequently, it's you know, I wrote a piece a few days ago that a lot of reporters, foreign reporters, Chinese reporters, went back 1 year anniversary. They were roughed up, they were attacked, physical handled. So this is a problem. And anyway, so. Why don't we just, do you have anything you want to say?
Oh, okay. I just want to thank Professor Kwong, because he invited me to join the crew, and because he had several rounds of cooperation with John Abbott and Matt O'Neill, but I was a new member to join the team, and because I was born and grew up in Sichuan. And also I'm specialized in Chinese local governance. And also 1 year before the earthquake, because I was traveling in the quake zone area. So this is why I put some pictures on my internet, on my homepage. So Professor Kwan, he noticed, he said, since you are from that area, so can you, you see, just do you like to come with us? I thought that invitation was very attractive. So this is why I said, of course. And so this is why I joined the crew, right?
Yeah, well, it's not because I respect your views on China as an analyst, and I didn't do you any favor.
Of course, it's a good thing.
Harry?
Did anybody try to confiscate your footage?
We took care of that before that possibility. And we wouldn't explain to you what, but we took care of that before that had happened. We thought there might be that possibility, so we took care of it. Yes?
Well, corruption at the local level has been well documented. And it seems like any time when there's corruption gets too big and there's fear over the public, you know, the central government cracks down on the local government. Why is it not happening at this time?
Well, let me answer this first.
Yeah,
I think it's a misunderstanding about what's wrong with China is basically local government that's corrupt. The corruption goes all the way up. It's a different kind of corruption. The kind of corruptions that in local area you could see. The central government high up, you know, everybody knows the princelings, the kind of sons and daughters of children of party officials. They occupy very, very important positions. They take upon themselves oftentimes, not in terms of 100 quiet or 200 quiet, they are in the billions. So I think the climate of corruption is through and through. And furthermore, everybody at first would say when they detain us, it was a local issue, right? Because the local officials get very upset, because if we investigate this stuff, if the parents in fact get to investigate this stuff, the several things comes out. The first thing is, how come nobody inspect these buildings? Because there's earthquake codes, right? And so officials are responsible. Secondly, Chinese, since the 1978, this new liberalization policy, been stripping away social welfare funding, including schools. So local schools, local communities, if they want to build school buildings, they have to raise funds, borrow money from the banks and all that kind of stuff. Because of a shortage of funds, they always shortchange the schools. And that's one. So in that event, we could understand why the local government is very sensitive. But the day we left, just a day on the day after we were detained, central government passed down an order that all foreign reporters and local reporters' permits are withdrawn. So in other words, this is not a local issue. This affects the whole profile of the rights of Chinese people, right? I mean, the only reason that they were very gentle with, as gentle as they could be, is because the parents. If you really, you know, crack down on parents, there would be. But the point I'm saying is that I don't see that difference in a major way.
Okay. One look at the relationship between the central government and the local government and the ordinary citizens in China. And I think there was a game of paper, rock, and scissors game. And basically, and we all know this game and the three things, and everyone can, you see, win in one time. And but you see, in China, I think, and the Chinese central government basically is trying to separate itself from any, you see, control from the local government and also from the people. So there's one dimension of control, and from the center to the local and to the people. So many things, and we think the local government is dealing with the people, but actually, and the Chinese is the central government actually is dictating. If the Chinese central government is playing the paper role, a soft face, and so basically, and the local government is going to be the, you see, rock, right? So and if the Chinese people become rebellious, right? So this is why I think, and I think this is the central issue, and why the central government did not kill one or two government officials, and or we call it to, you see, and kill the, you see, chicken to frighten the monkey, right? And I think one important reason is it's related to the patrimonial system in the local system in China. Why is that? And because and our star and the woman, she dyed her hair, and so we call her Blondie. And she is in the was is in the arguing with several villagers. So I asked her, I said, why did they argue with you? And so she said, because some of them, they thought, and because we made some troubles. So this is why the government did not, you see, give enough rescue materials to us. So this are through this kind of, you see, punishment. So they want to, you see, the villagers know, you have to give us your cooperation, you have to be cooperative, then we are going to give you rescue materials like get a coupon and rice and also tents and all this. And so this is what I think the Chinese government is using the distribution of materials to consolidate the local patronage, spoils, and the patrimonial network. And so this is why I think for the Chinese central government, if you are going to dig into this whole, you see, shoddy project, and the Chinese, they are boastful about their own engineers. So their legitimacy is from the technocracy. And so now, and even the engineers, and they cannot get the projects correct. And so I think that's something which is really devastating to their legitimacy. And also, I think if they are going to start, you see, punishing the local government officials, once they open up this huge network, so you are going to see and how the loyalty of the local government officials and the party activists and to the party and the state is going to be really weakened. So this is why I think the central government is hesitant.
Yes. Somebody else?
Okay.
Yes.
How did you come across the particular school that you did? Was it, did you know that the parents were getting ready to demonstrate at that school? That's why you went there, or you just by randomness just?
This is there? Actually chance.
Okay.
This
also,
is chance.
How extensive were other the parents of other schools? Were they, did you hear protests from other
yes.
schools also, the parents? Or was it just an isolated more?
No, there are quite a few schools that's demonstrated. As I mentioned, 2 days in a row, we encountered two different demonstrations. But this particular school is the second day we encounter, and it is the most militant. It is the parents are the most gutsy. They have 127 kids killed, but they were the ones that persisted. And so even today, when people want to talk, they look to these parents because they never gave up. Now, other places too had demonstration, but one of the things I think is very, very important to understand about Chinese officials, that is, if something happens at one place, they have to deal with it. But it is very, very important that that particular development does not spread somewhere else. So they make sure they cut the connections off. And so there are many other places did demonstrate, and Du Jiangyan has quite a few.
She's very, very nice,
yeah. And at least three or four major groups that's demonstrating. But we focus on this because this is the first group we found, and they were we were able to talk to them quite a bit. But I think it's very clear they try to make sure this thing doesn't spread, even though there are many other places that had demonstrations.
Can I just follow up? Mm-hmm. Were the parents from different schools, did they have a chance to link up, or was the government very effective in separating the parents from different
That would be schools? Something they make sure that doesn't happen.
So even now, the parents have not, it's more school-based demonstrations rather than individual school-based, rather than parents coming together from different schools to demonstrate.
What I'm trying to say is that they would make every effort to make that possibility unlikely. That doesn't mean they don't necessarily try to do that, right?
Yeah, let me add something. Because we were in the field, and so it was difficult for us to find clues, and because many townships and we were visiting, they were under the complete military or police control. Right, so this is why we were really frustrated, and because we could not find stories. So the second day, when we were driving on the road, and I saw many villagers, they were chanting and speaking loudly. So this is why I told the driver, I said, let's stop, and let me go there to see what's going on. Maybe I can find some interesting story there. So this is why I let the driver stop, so I went out. And so then I asked them, what's going on? Whether you are doing something here? They said, oh, nothing, we're just chanting. I said, what are you chanting about? And they said, oh, we're talking about in Fuxing school, and the parents, they put so many, wreaths there, and the memorial is huge. And they are today they are saying, because it's Sunday, because that's the 2 weeks. Because in the Sichuan local and tradition, in 2 weeks, that's the last day, and the spirits of the children, they're going to still and stay on the earth and to visit their family. And then after the 2 weeks, they will leave this world and to go to the other world. So this is why they said, and today they're going to have some actions. So this is why I think that was interesting. So this is why I told Jiang Airport, I said, how about, let's go there. And so this is why we drove there, and so we met the march, right? And we have to, whether the parents and they communicate, they coordinate. And certainly, you're a movie, and we have the reverse order. Actually, the Fuxing school march happened earlier, and the road blocking happened, 2 days later. And why? Because the Hanwang primary school actually was inspired and by the Fuxing primary school. So the parents, they got organized. But clearly you can see the Fuxing primary school is much, much better organized. The parents are more persistent, and also the parents are more resourceful in terms of how they frame their children pictures, how they try to work with the mass media. So then it gives me this question, and why Hanwang is an urban township, and the parents tend to have more resources. And Fuxing is a rural township, and so the parents are farmers. But why the farmers, they are more persistent, more resourceful, and more creative, and they manage the media much, much better. So it gave me this and the puzzle in my mind. So I tried to compare these two, and I think there is at least I can give you two explanations. One is the countryside people, they have their own piece of land. So at least the livelihood is, you see, assured by their own land. So this is how they are less dependent on the state and on the government. But the urban people, once the buildings, apartments, they were damaged, and so they were all to abandon their living compounds. And so this is how, for the countryside people, they could recover more resources from the damaged homes. But for the urban people, they could not. So I think I need to fix the resources. And second is, and every time when Hanwang and people, and also in Dujianyan and Xinjian Primary School and in Juyuan School, every time when they wanted to have a gathering, have a rally, and immediately the police responded. And because in China, the police system is stationed at the township level, not at the village level. So this is why the control itself left more space for the countryside people to organize, to plan. Right, so this is why I think you can find the fishing people, they became more, you see, creative, and they, you see, could organize much. And of course, the third factor I can say is, and the urban people, they have developed this nuclear family structure. And so this is how their parents, usually they are, you see, living independently from them. And once they got, you see, this disaster, many of them sent their family members, or they went out of the township to go to other family members and to live together. So basically abandoned the place, they did not participate anymore. But for countryside people, they live in three generations. And so this is how even they have to go out to protest, and usually family chores are still, you see, were still taken care of by the grandparents. So you can find different generations, they were alternating to try to give each other support. So I think the traditional support network in the countryside and clearly was working. But in the urban center, and there was no that kind of traditional network, and the community was damaged. So this is my explanation. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit about towards the end of the movie, there were a woman nicknamed Blondie was being criticized by people in the community for even talking to the reporters and the media, and they were saying, you know, don't let the foreigners know that China, you know, is doing anything bad, or try to let's try to show an image that, you know, we have social harmony, and that, you know, the government is treating us well. Can you talk about kind of that perspective?
Yeah.
And what it is in the people in that community that makes them fear that the, you know, China is going to be misportrayed or portrayed in bad light by foreigners?
That's a very, very interesting segment. We were talking to these people for quite a bit. We got to know them well, and at the same time, the local officials also became very weary. For instance, we were doing an interview at this lady's home, and all of a sudden, some official-looking people came and brought money. Say, you know, because such and such, we're going to give you a certain amount of money. They haven't seen them for weeks. All of a sudden, they come and deliver money. So they were there. They were very concerned that they were talking to the parents. We were talking to the parents and other people talking to the parents. They couldn't quite, you know, how to, in a rough way, to stop it. So from what I understand, they have been telling people at night after we left that these foreigners, these reporters are not reliable people. This goes back to the whole thing. You probably remember last year, the torch rally, right? The Olympic Games before the torch rally, and the many places, many cities, there was demonstration against these torch rallies. And so in China, people get very upset with this whole thing about CNN, BBC was not covering story truthfully. So this is the same line of logic, that the foreign reporters are distorting the news. So this thing becomes a theme all along, that foreign reporters are trying to distort the news. That's why he says, you know, report the truth, right? And this is what happened to us. But you know, we were detained for 8 hours. Went through all kinds of, you know, pretty awful stuff. And I was very upset. But then, you know, after 8 hours, everybody's worn out. Everybody wants to go home. They wanted to go home, too. And so the top guy, the top local guy, pointed at me. I don't know why he pointed at me. But he says, you should cover the truth. You should report the truth. And so all of a sudden, my weariness snapped out. I was ready to fight. I was saying, what are you talking about? We're not coming here to distort the truth. But by that time, I guess John and Matt dragged me out of that place. So that was the point, that if you report things they don't like,
it's
not telling the truth. And so that's a line. That's a very, very continuous line. So it's not just, these guys are not accidental there. They don't seem to be coming from that community. I don't know for a fact, but certainly there are people telling them not to talk to foreign reporters. They are bound to try to distort the truth.
Yeah, and you can see from the movie, and Peter was most heroic, right? And so it's not, and you can find this, and also I am thinking and related to the Lantis argument, right, between Blondie and her villagers, right? And I think there I see several different cards, and to understand, I think this is fascinating stuff. And one is because the background is actually in China was highly politicized. Why? Because the year was the Olympic year. And so this is why the Chinese government basically was preparing for huge, you see, and a political image improving project. But then, unfortunately, before that, then the Tibetan riots, you see, broke out. And then they lost a lot of his credit and damaged the image. And so when the Tibetan plateau was not quiet yet, then the Tibetan plateau is the Sichuan basin. And so the earthquake happened. So this is, I think, for the Chinese government. And so now they realize if this is a natural disaster, so they could just take advantage of it. And by highlighting, look, we have natural disaster, so now it's time to show our solidarity, this time, and to see how the party, the government, and the army, they are so, you see, great, and the people are vulnerable. So this is why I think the Chinese government politicized the entire, you see, the atmosphere in the country. So I think, and when the villagers, and they knew, and that was politically sensitive time. And also they knew, and if they showed their political loyalty, they could get material reward. So this is why I think, and you could see some activists, they try to, you see, support the party at that moment in order to, you see, get a material reward.
When you went there, because we didn't see from your film thing, what other kind of people were there to help the people? Because you were just here in this little village or whatever there. It's a big place. I mean, where it happened.
In the larger township, there were a lot of people coming from all over the world.
Right.
What is that town?
In Hanwang, you mean Hanwang, the Dutch Hanwang, search
Hanwang.
Team?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Hanwang, for instance, mm-hmm. there is a whole huge camp foreign groups, aid groups, had Korea, South Korea, Germany, and many, many other countries have brought resources, including Taiwan, brought resources to help. So it was a very moving kind of a solidarity situation.
We met and Hanwang, a Dutch search team, they brought three dogs, search dogs, and two, you see, and sniff the ground, and so they found several bodies, right? And we also saw, and there was one huge camp, is an International Children Fund, right? And so they were, you see, and taking care of the children, right?
They were trying to deal with the psychological trauma,
right?
So they were sending teams to the camps, trying to, right. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes.
Did you get a chance to talk to the Chinese press, the Chinese reporters, and what What kind of feedback were they coming out? Like, were they trying to, like, I guess, uncover this, but obviously once it gets to the editors, everything gets cut out.
I've never seen, we've been to China many, many times. I've never seen that many Chinese reporters covering a story. What was ironic was that there was one confrontation we had with officials there. We were trying to get in to see the parents, and the officials stopped us from doing that. And we made a lot of fuss. And so the local leader decided that since we make so much noise, let us in.
Crying babies get candy.
So Matt O'Neill and I were allowed to go in. In the meantime, I realized there were all these people behind me. I didn't know who they were. There were about 40 of them. They were all very quiet. I was one making the noise. And so the official let me in. The moment we got in, everybody behind screamed bloody murder. How dare you allow foreign reporters and not us? So everybody was there. And in the end, so there were a lot of reporters. And as you know, that media is thriving because so many newspapers, television stations are these days. Many of them are quite enterprising, even though most of them are not private per se. But anyway, so everybody's fighting for news, and they saw this as a very, very important news. And they, but by the time this thing happened, however, they already knew that the crackdown came. So and many of them talked to us, say, hey, look, you know, we got a lot of news. We can't print them. So, you know, we'd be glad to, of assistance. So yes, there are a lot of reporters, but every one of them, I went to a editorial, one particular paper sent 30 reporters. Mm-hmm. The guy was like commanding a commander troops. And so when I got there, he says, well, you know, this is it. As usually in China situation, you open up and you close it down. So he used the term that you go five steps forward and you end up walking six steps backward. So that was the title of my article talking about. So they were very, very, you know, they realized this is the kind of, they had the opportunity, they took it, but then when crackdown comes, they realize they can't go any further. So that's it. Until the next time. The Chinese reporters are very, very, what's the word? Ingenious, in a sense, and also very realistic.
Yeah, I think there is two important sideline stories, and we do not see from the movie, but since we were involved, so we could see and through our experiences. And one is the cops are omnipresent, and so now when look at it, so many images, actually they are the faces of cops. They were following us, and they were trying to find us and all this, right? So and I think and we took 58 hours of footage back, and I think and the Chinese authority, they took more than 58 hours on us. Right, so yeah, so this is a big thing. Sometimes I feel pity because why? Because I think why in China had to spend so much money on all this wasteful, you see, and expenses. So secondly, is we saw one big story is the media control, and the Chinese government basically tried to separate the media from the crowd. And Peter mentioned this one confrontation, and we just witnessed. The Chinese local officials, they were so brutal and aggressive, and to drag out this one woman reporter who was from the Xinhua news agency. And I was really surprised because Xinhua News Agency is supposed to be the mouthpiece for the party, for the central government, but then they just, you see, kicked her out. Right, so I think the local governmental officials, they were really scared. They wanted to silence and they want to keep reporters off the limit. Right.
Just one thing in addition to it. Some of the things they could not cover, they put it through internet. Not directly credit to them, but it appeared on the internet. So a lot of that stuff appeared for a few hours and then shut down, but then some of that news did come out. Henry? Oh, okay. Frank? Frank?
You guys, are you getting any kind of political repercussions here from the China side after the airing of this, these numerous times? Anybody knocking on your door 3 a.m?
Well, I've been there so many times. I actually went back to teach. I got back in April and May.
You cannot go back to teach now.
So in September, I went to Shanghai to teach. So I was there for 2 months. I think what's going on is that Chinese leadership is quite smart about crackdowns. Dissidents, intellectuals like us, they don't respect us. In other words, they don't think we're going to amount too much unless we do some crazy things, dealing with the people, masses.
Organizing.
So far, you know, there's no, whether we could go back or not, that's a different issue at this point. Frank.
Some questions about how the film was made and your relationship with the Chinese media. There's a sequence there that shows four video cams at the moment of the earthquake. So that obviously came from some source. Can we ask?
That's from the web.
How you
download from the web.
That was from the web. Okay. And do you know the locations, or it was just in the region?
We know the locations, and because when we were in the production process, editor is Adam Barton, and so and I was working with him. So because we got a disc kind of from Mianzhu, so the disc kind of was raw footage about the Mianzhu area. And so this is how we could look at the footage. And some, they are not from the internet. Some, they are from our collection and on Mianzhu. Right, so this is how we could identify, because all they are from Hanwang or Xinjiang or Fuxing. Right, so all from these three schools, we went there and to take a lot of pictures. Right.
So the other question is, did the Chinese media, who were themselves frustrated and who expressed a kind of solidarity with you all, did they provide you with any footage?
No. Yes.
This is the 1 year ago, right?
Yes.
I just wanted to know, is that in the result after that, officer got any problem, got punishment? After the story.
There's quite a few different things. I think we could go through that. Insofar as we understand, nobody was punished.
Nobody?
Nobody was punished, including the guy who was kneeling.
Jiang Guohua.
He was switched out, but it's a lateral change. So he was not punished. We don't know anybody punished. But I think the most important point is this. Up to today, the Chinese government has yet to give an accurate account of the people that were killed, the number of people that were killed, and the names of the people that were killed. Now, a lot of people in a lot of intellectuals in groups who activists want to know that. And so several groups actually on their own investigate. And in one case, the person was arrested for tampering state secret. Somebody else was somebody else was beaten up. Ai Weiwei was the guy who designed, one of the person designed the burst nets, right? He also organized a crew and door to door tried to talk to relatives of the victims and try to get names. And when he tried to go to the schools to find out, and school official basically say that's a state secret, the names are state secret. So they did come out with a number which is much, much lower than the earlier estimate, and it's also lower than the civilian count. So then finally, I thought this was a joke, but actually it was not a joke. The Chinese, Sichuan, I forgot exactly his title, he basically declared a few days ago that there is no tofu construction Dongcheng, and in the so in other words, so this has to do with our title, right? The title basically saying this is not the destruction is not all natural disaster, but they insist everything's natural disaster, right?
And let me add one thing. This is about the Sichuan government and has said, and so far there was no single school collapsed due to the quality reason. Mm-hmm. Right, so I think this is a very strong conclusion. And then if you look at our stars in the movie, and especially one man, and he was holding his son's picture, he said, "Give us justice," and he said, "My son is good and all four subjects, landman." And he was one of the leaders for the later lawsuit action. And so, and just several weeks ago, and he got a new son, and the son was born on the exact day and of his own birthday. Right, so, and he was interviewed and by either New York Times or Wall Street Journal, and he said, "And I always tell my son, and you have an older brother, and I try to get justice for him. He died wrongfully. If I cannot finish this pursuit, and you are going to continue," I think that's very powerful. Right.
A couple of observations, if I may. The way people react to death is very characteristic of popular Chinese culture. So that's no surprise, except that presumably China has been socialist since 1949, and there is no socialist way, apparently, to deal with death or with death that comes suddenly and massively. Second observation is that the story that you were sent out to get, which was, I gather, disaster relief in the contrast to Katrina, and presumably in contrast to the way other countries handled disaster relief. I'm trying to think of a country that experienced the disaster. Oh, Burma. Myanmar, where they refused all aid. And then the confusion in the tsunami about how different countries accepted, didn't accept, moved, didn't move to deal with the tsunami. And, well, the story that you tell is searingly real and exposes deep problems in Chinese society and governance and media. The other side of the story, apparently, relative to Myanmar, to Katrina, and so forth, was that in other sectors of disaster relief, there was indeed a national organization that was apparently as successful as it could be in the circumstances. So it's interesting that apparent success is not going to be seen, not going to be reflected. That's not to say that your story is in any way responsible for that, because your story has its own worth and its own integrity and its own importance and its own muckraking value. But I just observed that other side.
Yeah, Frank. We know this, that every natural disaster afterwards, people gonna point their fingers at somebody. That doesn't have to be Chinese. Everybody does that. Okay. So our story, right, is more than that. It's not simply about people complaining. It's about wanting the government to address those issues. And so I think it's the way they handle it is the question. American didn't handle the Katrina thing very well, but they didn't beat up their reporters reporting that. there are political consequences. George Bush says that the most depressing days of his years in office was the Katrina thing. So I think we're trying to bring out different aspect, not just about people complaining, right? Does that make China worse off than anybody else? No, we never intend to do that. I mean, the idea that somehow China is better than Burma is not what we're trying to say. Is not what we're trying to interest in saying, right? And so
the Chinese government will take care of that side of things. But of course, soon as the Chinese government does it, the credit.
Well, how do you know Chinese government are taking care of business? Do you have knowledge of how they're taking care of the relief efforts? You've seen the early stages from the television. Do you know exactly how they're taking care of things now?
I haven't investigated it closely, no.
Because you can't get any information from it, right? So what you're stating is, I don't know. But you haven't.
You yourself said that there was a national mobilization, and that's what I've heard from people who are in Sichuan.
No, you didn't hear me very correctly. Right. I said national mobilization at the very beginning. All right. It's not a question defensive about this thing. All I'm trying to say is, this is what we found. And as reporters, that's what we report, all right? And I think it's a larger issue than parents getting upset and complaining. And that's what I'm trying to say.
I didn't say that. And I think that your larger issue is well exploited. And I would go even further.
I think, just
one more sentence. The capturing on film and tape of the official who's talking presumably to another official to the effect, you know, how do we handle this? Well, we become commoners. What an exposure. And whatever else was said there, I've forgotten the other items, of, you know, sheer manipulation that was going on. So you have made a very fine documentary, and it makes its points very well. My point was simply that that other story, which has some international comparisons, is not there, and that's not your responsibility.
But what I'm trying to say is that nobody can report it. because reporters can't go there.
And they're not allowed to take out.
So I mean, let's assume they're doing a fantastic job, right? We don't know.
Yeah, may I attend the point Frank and you brought up? I think it's fascinating because not only we can have international comparison, and also I always think about this question is a historic comparison. And because I always think, and because after this disaster, I have been joined into the history of Chinese disaster and disaster relief efforts. And I think Chinese history, we call China is a country of sorrow, right? And some American scholars call it and a land of sorrow. And China is not a country which it does not see many disasters. China has a disaster every year, huge disaster every year. And so the Chinese historic pattern is always you have natural disaster, then you have famine. And then you have dislocation of the population, you have huge, you see, refugees, and then you have more deaths. Right, so clearly, and the Chinese Communist Party and broke this historic pattern in two different ways. One is during the Great Leap Forward, there was no huge natural disaster, but there was huge famine, the biggest in human history. And then there was huge deaths, but there was no riots and demonstrations and rebellions. So I think the Chinese Communist Party, because of its totalitarian nature of the control system, and so this is why they could easily do that. And then now we got into a new pattern, and there was natural disaster, but there was no famine. There was no refugee, you see, dislocation of refugees. There was no epidemic. I think that's a great achievement, and we can credit to the Chinese people and the economic development, and of course, the Chinese government, you see, did many things and in good way. But then my question is, if I follow your question is, and why? And the big, you see, the message the Chinese Communist Party want us to know and said, look, you should not send the mark rake the small mistake, and you should focus on the big positive picture. But why? And so many people, they said, okay, we have to get into this. This thing is not small, and it's big. And I think the Chinese government made a huge mistake is they thought, and the children, they are killed anyway. In human history, in Chinese history, always every natural disaster kills the children first. Sometimes the parents kill their children first, and to practice cannibalism. But this time, clearly, it's not, you see, an exception in Chinese history. The children died more. But then the question is why the parents, they got food security from the Chinese government, but then they still are not happy, they're still angry. And I think that's because the one family, one child policy, and tremendously is increased the value of each child in the hearts and in the eyes of the parents. So this is why I think the Chinese government and could not, you see, have sympathy and empathy for the parents who lost the children. The children were their, you see, best investment. They put everything, all their love. And so this is what I think, and for the Chinese people, we have the parents, they said, I'm not asking for money. I want justice. I want to prevent to happen in the future. And this is a lesson of blood. And I was struck. Because I mean, we have this people living relatively at the lower rung of Chinese society. They are pursuing post-materialist values, justice, human security, and also the human dignity. Especially Blondie, and she was talking about how her daughter was mistreated because they had to carry her on foot and to bury her immediately. And so then the father said, and another father, and he said, we had to spare our daughter here, but I made a coffin for her. If you listen to this, I can see the parents, what kind of strong love they have for their children. So this is why they are asking for dignity. So when we see the suddenly you see the strong demand for post-materialist values, and I think that's the great progress we have seen and among the Chinese people. I think this kind of progress is clashing with the Chinese government, the traditional authoritarian way, and which thinks if you are materialistically well-fed, well-sheltered, so you should shut up. Mm-hmm. So that's what I think is interesting.
Excellent point. Mm.
Right. One last question?
Yes.
Yes. In the movie, the parents and the family were given money. I'm just wondering if they get any kind of help from the government regarding their mental health. For instance, you know, they are affected by this tragic and traumatic event.
You go ahead. Okay. They have some resources, but very limited. that's why the children's group that came from, they're from England, actually, sent quite a few psychiatrists to help. I think that's the area that probably it's not on their top list.
I think there's one interesting thing. The Chinese government sent a lot of military staff and personnel and to the area, and of course many doctors from the army they were also in the around, and they sometimes and when the mothers they really became so you see distraught and disturbed, and so I saw and some reports I also saw some other documentaries and about how the military tried to say send medical doctor and psychologist and to try to counsel and the mother right and who lost you see and her only child right, and another important thing is I think and the Chinese government and as I said has not is it gone to that level and think our psychological health and is the top priority. So that's what I feel, and the government and the needs to you see, develop you see, much, much more modern thinking, or they should have some post-materialist values so they can appreciate people's you see, and the needs and wants, right?
Okay, well, Professor Kwong and Professor Xia will stay afterwards to entertain your questions personally, one-on-one. For those of you who are interested in seeing the documentary again, it's airing tomorrow on HBO.
Actually, it's going to be all the way to the end of this month.
Well, so this month, but for tomorrow's schedule, it's
yes.
10:15 a.m. and 5:45 p.m.
Okay. So if you want to download it, that would be great. How can I download it?
Round of applause.